This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet, and this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the TAPR conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive. So it was a pretty good high quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal. And you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive. And I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it. And when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see TAPR DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see TAPR DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009. And those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from TAPR. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the TAPR conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the TAPR banquets, TAPR forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a TAPR talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. TAPR and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them. And that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the Ham Radio Now .tv website, or more specifically to hamradionow.tv/ TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever TAPR talk this is.
All right. So welcome back. How was lunch?
Very, good.
Even for just cold sandwiches, so we'll feed you with a hot meal. Yeah, everything's been really tasty. I've really been glad of that. So let's make an introduction for Mark Griffith, KD0QYN, and his talk on Raspberry Pi 9600 baud TNC.
Thank you to the ARRL and TAPR for asking me to present again this year. I try to keep my talk nice and lively for all you people that want to go to sleep after lunch. And I have a bunch of slides. I'm going to zing through them pretty quickly, and I tend to talk fast. But save all your questions to the end, because I might be covering something you have a question for like two slides later on. So this is the new TNC Pi 9K, the 9600 baud TNC for the Raspberry Pi. That's a picture of one. This is the same thing in real time, in real world, that's right. And you can all have a look at it if you promise not to break it and give it back to me, because it's the only one of the two that exist right now. The board is based on the TNC microcomputer from PJRC Electronics. You can see the TNC is the big board in the middle. It was developed by John Weissman of G8BPQ fame. He also was either the developer or one of the primary developers for the current Pi TNC board. The TNC is actually pretty small, 2.4 by 0.7 inches by about 20.25 inches thickness. So it's basically the size of a stick of gum. And on that board, it has 180 megahertz ARM processor with a built-in floating point and 512 megabytes of RAM. I mean, it's amazing what you can cram into a tiny space nowadays. Amazing. All the other components, you see two other components on there. One of them is just a dual op amp for processing the receive and transmit audio signals. And there's a digital potentiometer for setting levels, and then there's a transistor for doing push-to-talk. That's it. All the other components are for operating the LED lights. And that's it, really. Some of the resistors are bigger because I couldn't find the, whatever it is, 0.8 watts or, you know, 1/8 watts resistors. So I used what I could find. But I don't know what it'll look like. It has the ability to have a DB9 connector on the right-hand side plus a 9-pin DIN. I didn't plug the DB9 in because I wasn't going to use it. You can see, that on the left-hand side is a little mini USB port for doing uploading of programming. And also on the right-hand side is a mini SD card. In this implementation, it's not used at all. So everything is done in software. The entire TNC is done in software. It's done in the C programming language in the Arduino software development tool for Windows. It's based on the original Thomas Saylor's super sound modem software from years ago. John Weissman took that, upgraded it, modified it, improved it to give the capabilities that we have. The mini USB card on the left, you plug that into your Windows computer, you run the development software, it'll compile it and then upload it to the TNC. And once it's uploaded to the TNC, it's there. It also can support the new RDOT protocol, which is coming out, I believe, next year for the Windows team. They've been talking about it for a while, but I think next year is the official rollout. And which gives you capability of a little bit higher than 1200 baud packet. There's no software switch right now. Right now, to enable the RDOT mode, you have to change a header, a C header file, and change a define in a header file, recompile, and re-upload the software. But an RDOT to be used in Linux requires a driver, which is not yet available. But John Weissman wisely put one into his LinBPQ software so it can be used with his BBS software. So since it appears to the Raspberry Pi as a hardware KISS TNC, it's a direct plug-in replacement for the current TNC. And it'll operate at 1200 baud or 9600 baud. There's also a 2400 baud mode that's available. You can actually set it up to run 2400 baud. John Weissman in his testing took two boards and wired them directly together, and the 2400 baud mode worked fine. but you put radios in the middle, which is what I did, and I couldn't get it to work right. Sometimes it would decode correctly, sometimes it wouldn't. I think if I played around with the receive and the transmit level some more, maybe I might be able to get it to work, but I didn't really mess with it because it's only going to be like 1.3 times faster than 1200 baud. So let's get some definitions out of the way for to make sure we're all talking on the same level, and for some of the purists out there, baud rate and BPS are the same thing. Bits per second and baud are the same thing. The bit error rate is the number of errors divided by the total bits sent. It's always expressed as a negative power of 10, you know, 1 times 10 to the negative nth power. CRC, the cyclic redundancy check, is an error detecting code. It's not the error correcting, detecting code. It's used everywhere, even on your computer when it writes to your hard drive. It does a CRC check on all whatever it is in hard drive language to your hard drive. Was that sectors? Something like that.
Blocks.
There it is. Thank you. Frames and packets for the purists out there. Both are packages of data moving through a network in the OSI model. If you don't know what the OSI model is, look it up on the internet, but we don't have time to go through it today. Frames are units of data in the link layer. Packets are units of data in the network layer. Both terms are often used interchangeably, but it's not technically correct. I use them interchangeably. Please forgive me. Okay, now, from my perspective, if anybody here does not know about the Pi Gate system, talk to me later on after this is over. From my perspective is I have you have a Pi Gate system in one vehicle with a Pi Gate RMS server in the other end connected to the internet. I want to be able to transmit email. I want to be able to transmit email and files as fast as possible. That's why I was interested in in this project. So let's talk radio data transfer speeds now. Highly dependent upon the frequency bandwidth available. For example, over-the-air digital TV requires 6 megahertz, which is the same bandwidth that was available for the old analog TV, 6 megahertz for a 32 megabits per second transfer rate. They get more with compression, obviously, but that's how much bandwidth you need for that speed. 4G LTE phones can require up to 20 megahertz of bandwidth to get 300 megabits per second downloads. 20 megahertz, that's almost the entire width of the HF spectrum. So if you want to get fast downloads, you got to have a wide bandwidth. Unfortunately for radio, amateur radio, we don't get that capability. Slow scan TV, for example, must fit into a 3 kilohertz single sideband transmission. This is why it's slow, because you don't have the bandwidth. You can determine the capabilities of how much capacity you're going to get using this Shannon-Hartley theorem by these two smart guys. I think it was early 1940s, maybe the 1930s, I forget, that they came up with this. I'm not a math whiz. If anybody up here can look at that and instantly see how it works, that's great. I can't do that. So I plugged in that formula into a spreadsheet, and I worked out some things, and some of my answers came out to be the same that were on the internet, so I figured I got it right. Where's Steve Hicks? Is Steve Hicks still here? There he is, Steve. Thank you yesterday for talking about noise, because noise is the biggest thing that's going to limit your channel capacity. The amount of noise that you have based on watts, which we found out yesterday, is you take dBm and you convert it to watts. That's how they do it. So thank you, Steve, for explaining all that in much more detail so I don't have to go over it. So I determined that by an average 15 kilohertz wide FM signal, wideband FM, you can get up to 100 kilobits per second possible under the best conditions, which is no noise. Now, the more noise you get, that rate's going to go down. So 9600 baud, or 9.6 kilobits per second, should be easily within reach. Now, let's talk some real quickly about some packet frequencies. Not everybody realizes you could do 1200 baud packet on 10 meters. I don't know of anybody that's found it to be successful, but we do have the capability to do that. 6 meters, 1200 baud also works in low noise environments. 2 meters and up, 1200 to 9600. Actually, I think in, 220 on up, you can do 19.2 and 38.4. I forget, but the sky's the limit once you get up into the UHF range. 220 megahertz may be the ideal packet band. It's hard to find radios for it, though, especially that'll do packet, because it has low noise but still has some of the propagation advantages of 2 meters. I'd like to play around with that. It's especially useful if you can control both ends of the comm link, such as with the Pi gate and the Pi gate RMS system. You can choose whatever frequency you want, as long as you have the license to do that and the mode supported. So packet radio modulation, real quick, 2 modes, audio frequency and frequency shift keying. Everybody knows what that is? All right, they've been used for a long time with RIDI. A long time. I don't know anybody that can listen to a RIDI signal on the air and tell if it's AFSK or frequency shift keying. They sound the same. So roughly around 4,500 baud. There are a lot of RIDI purists that won't use audio frequency shifts. They only will use FSK. But it's, to me, it sounds the same. Okay, so let's talk about 9,600 baud packet now. You can't use audio coupling to your transceivers, because the audio circuits on your radio are designed for the human voice. They won't handle the frequency range that you need to be able to transmit 9,600 baud packet without introducing noise and distortion. So you can't use audio frequency shift keying for 9,600 baud. You have to use true FSK. There's no tones. When you transmit at 9,600 baud on FM, it just sounds like static. The static level goes up. That's what you hear. It's very susceptible to noise. Steve will verify that. He's the expert. It requires a strong signal for a link, a very strong signal. And it can only be used with radios that are designed for 9,600 baud packet. Not all radios have that capability. The ones that do will have a little port in the back, a packet port in the back. Where's the thing? Right there. A little packet, it'll say packet on there. And you can use that for either 1,200 or 9,600 baud packet. There's two different lines that go through. So because the radio has to be designed for that, no more Baofangs. Thank God. I don't know how many times I have talked to people about why they can't make a connection through 1,200 baud packet because they're using a crappy Baofang. It does work. I have two of them. I got two of them right here, and I have used these to do all sorts of testing. They do work, but they're very touchy, and you have to set them up correctly to get them to work properly, or they just won't do it. But for the most part, you don't want to use a Baofang. And with 9,600 baud, you can't anymore. So let's talk about the bit error rate. The bit error rate, like I said, is determined a lot of times by the ARRL when they do their testing. They do a testing of a new radio, and they will publish the bit error rate many times, not all the time. They don't always publish it. I don't know why that is. Where's the ARRL guys here? Why do you not always publish the bit error rate? Like, for instance, that picture is a Yaesu FT7900. It's got a nice review in QST. They don't publish the bit error rate. I don't know why. The manufacturers don't publish it, and you can't find this stuff on the internet. The only place I've found where you can find this is with the ARRL product reviews. Only radios with a good bit error rate will work. If you don't have a sufficient bit error rate, you will not be able to use 9,600 baud packet. Think about it for a second. If you have a radio that has the bit error rate is published as 1 times 10 to the negative third, that means what? One packet in every 1,000 will have an error. If you have a 256 byte packet you're transmitting, that's more than 1,000 bits, right? And so that means every packet you transmit is going to have an error in it, technically speaking. They won't work. To me, a good bit error rate is 5 times 10 to the negative 4th, less than 5 times 10 to the negative 4th, which is less than 5 bit errors for every 10,000 bits sent. Now, I say to me is because my radios, the FT7900s, work. And that was one of the published bit error rates. But I did a lot of looking around through the QST and in the the proceedings of the conference, my paper has there has a list of a lot more radios, but these nine radios are the only ones that fit that definition of having less than 5 × 10⁻⁴. Now, these are all mobile radios. All the $15,000 and $20,000 base station radios, they have good bit error rates. But the mobile radios, these nine, are the ones that fit that definition. If you have a radio that's in that list, you're good. If you don't, and you want to do 9600 baud packet, well, you either can't or you're going to have to buy yourself another radio. The two ones down there at the bottom from Kenwood, the TMD700s and the D710, those were the best ones. Their bit error rates was for all the transmit receive on all, both frequencies were all less than 1 × 10⁵. That means less than one bit error rate for every 100,000 bits sent. They had the best ones. But the other ones will work too. So again, my perspective, what I'm looking at is I'm looking at two radios miles apart connecting through packet and sending files as fast as possible. So why do I want 9600 baud? Well, duh, it's faster. It's faster than WinMore. It's faster than PAC-TOR 1, 2, or 3. Actually, PAC-TOR 4 in low noise environments will be a little bit faster. But 9600 baud cranking away as fast as possible was faster than that. You have the ability to transfer larger files in a reasonable amount of time. Reasonable meaning if you take your cell phone, you can download a file really fast because you got that 300 megabits per second download rate because it's got the wide bandwidth. Reasonable on amateur radio is like the difference between 20 minutes and 4 minutes. All right, that's a big difference. There's no correction error correction protocol. I think TAPR, though, a few years ago, they had a forward error correction version of packet that they come out with. I don't think anybody's ever used it, but there was a spec for that. So there's no forward error correction protocol. A good signal link is a must. You got to have a good signal, or else it's not going to work correctly. So in what real-world situations would I want to faster data transfers for? So imagine you're down in Florida at a disaster shelter down there. Again, this is my perspective, emergency communications. You're down in Florida, you're at an emergency shelter, there's no power, there's no digital communications, no network, no internet. The only thing we have to get information in and out is amateur radio, because amateur radio always gets through, right? Give a cheer for amateur radio. Oh boy, that was pretty weak. So what real-world situations would I want? Well, if I'm down there and I go outside, I see some ominous clouds staring back at me. I'd like to know if those ominous clouds mean something or if they're just a local thunderstorm for the afternoon. I'd like to be able to get some weather information. Now, if NOAA weather radio is available at the location you're at, that's great. If they're not, you might be able to send an email to somebody and say, hey, you know, excuse me, what's my weather going to be tomorrow? I would like to be able to get something like this. I'd like to be able to request that and have it transferred back down to my computer as that 54 kilobyte GIF file. And if you know how to read weather maps fairly easily, you can tell what your weather is going to be like. People in Florida, this was taken a week before Irma, and they were expecting a lot of rain. Here in Missouri, right in the middle, hey, back then it was nice weather. Everybody could see that. Or I might want to go down and get a 72-hour forecast for the tropics. There's Irma churning away and its projected path. And then I saw, what is that behind Irma? What the heck is that? Jose. That was before the news media was even talking about Jose. There it is on the weather map, churning away with the same forecast path as Irma. That would be nice to know. If I was sitting in a emergency shelter in Florida, that there's two hurricanes coming my way. I'd like to know that. Here's a 24-hour wind and wave forecast, 51K. There shows Irma in the middle. If you can see it shows the winds 150 knots forecast over the peaks 185 knots. Look at that. Wind seas to 56 feet. Wow. That's from one trough to the height of the next wave, but I got a 2.5-story house that's twice as tall as my house. I would not want to be out there in a boat in that. And there on the left-hand side or right-hand side is Jose coming along with only 13-foot seas. Oh boy, that's a lot better. If I was on HF radio, I could get a WeFax through FLDigi. Now, but there's noise, that's what they look like. If you look really closely, all right, up in this area, you can see the outline of England. I can't make out anything else. I think that's France over there. But that's what you get when you have a noisy environment. I would rather get something that looks like that compared to something that looks like that and get it a lot faster, too. So that's my perspective. I want to be able to transfer files, fairly large files, quickly to my disaster site and get this kind of information. So what kind of data transfer rates can I expect? Well, 9600 baud packet is mathematically 8 times faster than 12. Are you going to get that? No. The actual throughput will be much slower because of the ARQ protocol. The ARQ protocol is that where it sends data and then it waits for acknowledgement, sends more data, waits for an acknowledgement, sends more data, waits for acknowledgement. That is exactly what happens when you transfer files over the internet using TCP/IP. The problem is that amateur radio is simplex, the internet is duplex. It could be sending acknowledgements back without stopping the stream that's coming down. Amateur radio, you got to stop the data stream, wait for the acknowledgement, go back to the data stream, and that slows things down a lot. With 1,200 baud packet, you actually only get about 800 bits per second, not 1,200 because of the ARQ protocol. With 9,600 baud, because of the ARQ protocol, it slows it down even more because you're spending a more significant amount of time in the protocol than you actually are transmitting data. So it slows it down a lot more. There are many variables that can change the transfer rate, lots of them. Propagation, errors coming from that, errors from multipathing, errors from QRM. There's all sorts of things that can slow down the 9,600 baud. You're just too far away. And it's more sensitive at 9,600 baud. So the errors and the subsequent resending of packets can slow the transfer rate down to the point where it's not going to be any faster than 1,200 baud. So whenever an error, a packet error is received, remember the CRC, the transmitter sends a packet, and along with it, it sends the CRC value. The receiver gets it, it calculates the CRC. If it's not the same, it rejects it. And what does the sender have to do? The sender has to back up, re-queue up that packet, and send it out again until it gets an acknowledgement, and then it continues on. It slows everything down a lot. So you need to have a good radio link. How many times have I said that? You can hear me say it more. Nice big antennas. A good radio link. If you're serious about transferring data high speed across radio, you got to have a good link. That's why some of these, the mesh networks, they work great as long as they're all within, what, half a mile or 2 miles of each other, depending on your propagation and your antennas. So, did I miss a slide? No. Okay, so now let me explain the test environment. I wanted to eliminate all the variables that I possibly could. So I had two of these TNCs that I built, set up exactly the same. I used two FT7900 radios, so the radios were not an issue. And I was connected through the data packet port in the back. I had a Pi Gate RMS device connected to a radio which had an antenna on the roof of my house, a 2 meter, 70 centimeter omnidirectional antenna, and a Pi Gate system in the basement with a zero gain whip antenna on it. That was my test environment. Two floors and a roof between them to try to attenuate the signal somewhat. And I did this so I could they could be plugged into the internet on my house, and I could, you know, SSH log in into both devices and change things and modify stuff and see how it. So that's why I did it that way. Both radios were set for 433 megahertz. Why? Because you couldn't get 9600 baud to work on 2 meters, even that close together. The noise in my house was probably the limiting factor. Again, Steve explained how that works, but I couldn't get it to work on 2 meters at all. It would make an initial connection, and then it would fail halfway through. Now, maybe when I get back home, I'll do some more testing with the radio outside of my basement and see if I can get that to work. But 1,200 baud worked fine. Both radios were set to transmit 5 watts. Both radios were unsquelched to prevent any kind of delays due to unsquelching to have to receive a packet. And the packet parameters were set up on both software programs to be exactly the same. And I use the same file all the time for all the transfer tests. Now, here's the test results. And I say as measured by LIN-BPQ. In the paper, in the proceedings, I had some data rates that I did some initial calculations for. And I was calculating them based upon looking at the packet output and determining when the data packets were starting to be sent outside of the protocol set up in the handshaking, when the data packets were being sent and when they were stopped being sent. And I was getting all sorts of different calculations, mostly because of my inability to be able to subtract hours, minutes, and seconds correctly. So there's got to be a better way. So LIN-BPQ, when it's done transferring a file, it says, I transferred X number of bytes in this many seconds. I said, I'll just use that. But that is also means that it's going to actually slow down the transfer rate a little because it's also including all the data handshaking going back and forth in the protocol before the data is actually being sent. But it's consistent. I could transmit the same file. It would show the same number of bits, plus or minus maybe one bit, and the exact same time. So I use those as the standard. So here we go, drum roll. There's the test results, the first set. I looked at those and I'm like, that sucks. 9600 baud, if you look at it, it's 2.8 times faster than 1200. Only 2.8 times faster. And if you notice how in 1200 baud and 9600 baud, as the files get smaller, the transfer rate in the bits per second gets smaller too, because it's doing what? Spending more time in the handshaking in the protocol than it is actually transmitting data. But I said 2.8 times. Man, I'm going to be ashamed to go put that and display that. And I was kind of ashamed to talk to John Weissman and tell him what was going on. So I conversed with John Weissman. Oh, I'm sorry. And here's the actual time in minutes. On the left-hand side is 112 kilobyte file, 54 kilobyte, 10 kilobyte, 5 kilobyte. You notice the difference in time on the 110 kilobyte at 1200 baud, it's 18 and a half minutes, down to like 6.5 minutes at 9600. It's still significantly faster when you're transmitting large files, even though the transfer rate wasn't as high as I wanted it to be. 54K, it's several minutes faster. And you notice how, as the files get smaller, the time difference gets smaller too. Why is that? It's spending more time in the protocol than it is actually transmitting data. That's right. It'll eventually get down when the file is small enough to where a 9600 baud packet won't be an advantage at all to 1200. I don't know where that limit is, but eventually it'll get down to where there's no advantage. So I talked to John Weissman, and I said, this sucks. What am I doing wrong? So we talked about it a little bit, and we decided to make one change in one parameter. On your radios, on your your VHF and UHF radios, as published by the ARRL, when they decide to publish it, there's a value called the transmit recovery time. The transmit recovery time is the amount of time it takes from the time the transmitter is unkeyed to the time that the output on the audio level will be at least 50% of maximum. And that's measured in milliseconds. So for my two FT7900s at 144 megahertz, 145 megahertz, it was measured at 126 milliseconds. At 440 megahertz, it was measured at 96 milliseconds. So I had the transmit delay time on the modem, on the card, set to half a second. So it would wait a half a second before it would start to transmit again. So I said, let's knock that down. So I knocked it down to 100 milliseconds, and the two things couldn't talk together at all. Nothing happened. So I bumped it up to 200 milliseconds. So now all I did was change the transmit delay parameter on the TNC Pi 9K from 500 milliseconds to 200 milliseconds. And here's the result. You can see now it's a significant result. In terms of its how it compares to 1200 baud, it's now transferring data at slightly over four times faster than 1200 baud. And that's not too bad. That was more like what I was expecting. I was expecting somewhere between three and five. Four times faster is what you can get. And it gets the same slope there. As the smaller the file gets, the less the bit per error, bits per second rate is. So that's consistent. So I said, okay, we're doing pretty good. We have measured it with the time. Remember, here was the old version of the time and results. It's changed that one parameter. Now, that 112 kilobyte file is being received 2 minutes faster than it was before, just by changing that one parameter. And then you can see when you get down to 5K, there's almost no difference. So 9600 baud in this situation, with the current parameters that we have in the current software, you can transfer files 4 times faster than you can at 1200. The difference between 18, almost 19 minutes and 4 minutes or 4.5 minutes, that's a big deal when you're transferring big files. To me, does anybody think that's not a big deal? If you are, do raise your hand. Oh, there's one guy. There's one guy. All right, there's always one. So that's, oops. So again, a good signal link is required. You can't do 9600 baud packet with a whip antenna on the back of your car, unless you're sitting like right outside the station where you're transferring files from. It's not gonna work. What we need is something like this. If you want high-speed data transfers, you're gonna have to invest in a decent radio that has a good bit error rate and some decent antennas. Obviously, I don't know who that KC3RE guy is. He's got a lot of money, a Land Rover, all those antennas. I don't know who the other guy, I can't see the call sign on that other one. But that's what you're gonna have to do if you wanna have high-speed data transfers over the internet, over amateur radio with 9600 baud packet. How much is this gonna cost? That's the question everybody's thinking. Is anybody not thinking that question? Oh, there's always one. This board here, we're not sure yet how much it's gonna cost. The TNC board, which is the major component, is $29.95 from PJRC Electronics. Like you said, the other components are not very much, a few dollars more. The cost of the board and whatever profit that they want to make, whoever the distributor is going to be, we're still figuring that the boards are going to come in to be less than $100. That's pretty good. And you get all the capabilities plus the RDOT protocol if you want to use it, which is a sound, you know, that you connect that to your signal link and connect to your HF radio and use RDOT that way. So that's how much they're going to cost. How they're going to be delivered, we don't know exactly yet who's going to do it, but it's probably going to be John Hansen, who does from Coastal Chip Works, who does the current TNC Pis. Okay, questions, and who? The first guy should be the guy that's going to tell me how they could have done it better. Any questions? Come on, you guys, go ahead. Oh, even they get the microphone. Where's the mic runner? There he is.
Paul K, 5FPT. With that board, you said it came with that little micro...
This is the TNC?
Yeah, the TNC. Is that going to come on the board already? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, without that, it doesn't work.
What packet size were you using in your tests? What packet size?
I set everything up to be the maximum. The packet length was 256 bytes. And the size of the window was 7. So now there is a new standard in packet where you can set the number of packets up to 32. And John Weissman and I talked about that. He hasn't implemented it yet in any of his programs, but that was set for the maximum. Obviously, it's funny, if you change the packet length from 256 down to 128, it doesn't really make that much difference. It's kind of interesting. I was surprised by that. But you change the number of maximum number of packets in a group that's sent. Yeah, that really changes the rate.
When working with small files, would it help to pipe them all through a tar.gz type of thing to get on the fly, putting them all into one larger file stream?
Yeah. Well, in the case of like the PiGate system, right? And this is from my perspective again. You're sending an email, and you're going to send an attachment on the email. You can zip up as many files as you want and put them in that attachment. That's the way of getting faster data transfers anyways, to take files, compress them, and ship them off. Then your theoretical bits per second rate, you know, really climbs, even though the transfer rate's not any faster. Is anybody else? Oh, yes.
So just out of curiosity, have you considered doing like a full duplex mode? Maybe using using radios that are capable of duplexing across VHF and UHF and say using the VHF as your ACK channel and using UHF as your transfer channel, and then you wouldn't have to have the latency between T and R.
Right.
I'm just thinking it.
Yeah, I've actually have thought of that. There is a back years ago, back in the 1980s, I was doing some programming stuff with CompuServe. Anybody here? Everybody remember CompuServe? Okay. To download files from CompuServe, you either had a choice of using X modem, which was really slow, or you could use this what they call this CompuServe B plus protocol. If anybody here remember the CompuServe B plus protocol? You do, okay. I wrote a program for the OS9 operating system to download using the B plus protocol. And the thing about the B plus protocol, since the internet is full duplex, it would just stream the data and then the receiver would just send back acknowledgments constantly. And when those acknowledgments stopped, the transmitter would stop, figure out what packet it needed to resend it, and go on again. But it's a full duplex mode. The problem we have with amateur radio, it's simplex. So yeah, we would have to set up two radios, different frequencies, and then we'd have to rewrite the software to be able to do that kind of interchange. That's something I have thought of, yeah. You're a pretty smart guy. If you thought of the same thing I have, you're a pretty smart guy. I'm sorry.
Have you looked at the Northwest Digital UDRC2 to do higher speed stuff?
No, I haven't. Okay. I don't even know what that is, sorry.
Oh, well, you have a reference.
I'll look it up. Yeah, we're just doing packet, regular old packet, just faster speeds, because it supports what I'm doing, it supports what John Weissman's doing. Anybody else? Nobody else?
Okay, thank you very much.
You don't want to comment on my nice shirt or anything like that?